Yes, a large chunk of the country has been hammered by a fierce winter storm this week. But even so, scientists and businesses are concerned we've seen less accumulation and faster melts in places that crave deep powder, the ski slopes. Ari is back with our story, part of our series, Coping with Climate Change.
It's peak ski season in Aspen, Colorado. The mountain town draws tens of thousands of visitors from around the world every winter just for the snow. For championship skier Chris Davenport, skiing is more than just a pastime.
Skiing through powder snow, champagne powder as we call it here in Colorado, is almost an indescribable experience. You've got gravity pushing you down the hill. The snow is sort of coming up over your body silently. The air is cold, it's blue sky, and these crystals are sort of glistening in the air. It's almost an out-of-body experience, and that's the thing that makes gets skiers addicted to the sport.
But these days, Davenport is worried his sport is headed for a fall.
You don't know if you're going to have good snow. You don't know if it's going to come early or late, or if the spring is going to become warm and the season's going to end prematurely. We just don't have that dependability anymore.
Yeah, so looking right at the bottom, we're seeing...
Those variations are what Mark Williams, a snow hydrologist at the University of Colorado, has been studying.
In terms of climate change, the parameter that's going to change the most is snow. In particular, we're starting to lose snow on the shoulders. That is, snow accumulation starts later and snow melt starts earlier. And that's going to have all kinds of repercussions in terms of water availability, in terms of recreation, in terms of ecosystem services. The list goes on.
The 2011-2012 winter season was the fourth warmest on record for the United States, according to the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. That year, Colorado saw only half its average snowpack, making it the worst ski season in 20 years. And Williams thinks it could get worse.
We knew that our work showed that snowmelt's going to start earlier. We're going to start to lose some of that late season snow, but it didn't look like it was going to really be a problem until we get 30 or 40 years into the future. However, what we saw last year, March 2012, there essentially was no snow. I mean, first time ever, it was the lowest snowfall here in Boulder on record. So there's reason to be concerned.
Across the country, on a small community ski hill, the realities of warmer winters are felt more acutely.
We're here at Canton Mountain Ski Area in Campton, New Hampshire, part of Waterville Estates, and that's our 1969 Stedley compact double chairlift, an oldie but a goodie. And then over to your left there is our rope tow. Families just love watching the kids out there, and lots of people have learned to ski right there on that little hill, you know.
It's more a community resource than a profit center, but due to low snow, it's been closed since 2011.
And we get the emails from the members every day. They're just, when's it opening? They want to know. The kids want to know. The families want to know. Everybody wants to know. Just, we can't do it. We just don't have the, I mean, it looks white, but if you went over that with skis that you cared about, they'd be ruined.
The lack of steady and deep snow has measurable economic effects across the country. Visits to ski resorts were down 15% nationwide in 2012.
And what we found is that there is a pretty big impact. And when you have a lower than average snowfall winter, you've got about $800 million of unrealized revenue in the United States. And it can cost the U.S. about anywhere between 13,000 and 27,000 jobs.
Elizabeth Burkowski is a climate scientist at the University of New Hampshire. She co-authored a report looking at the economic impact of a bad season on the winter sports industry.
By the end of the century, some regions are going to be seeing winter temperatures that are anywhere between 6 and 12 degrees Fahrenheit warmer than they have been in the past couple decades. And that spells trouble for our ski industry.
Even in a wealthy resort community like Aspen, a slow ski season means losses.
We do. What are you looking for?
Dan McMahon, whose shop is at the bottom of Aspen Mountain, does not want another winter like the last one. In March, his ski rental business tumbled 20 to 30%, and the losses snowballed for the rest of the year. For McMahon, low snow means high costs.
If it's a low snow year, you know, our skis are going to get beat up, people are hitting rocks, more equipment gets broken, and a lot, it just gets damaged more, so we spend a lot more on our staff, bring in more people to help tune the skis.
Have a good run.
Mike Kaplan, CEO of the Aspen Skiing Company, says the industry operates within a very small window every year.
Our business is make or break business based on really 4 months of the year. You know, we're open about 140 days a year, but it's that Christmas through March period where, you either make it or you don't.
Snow guns like these are a ski company's last resort against warmer temperatures. But even here in Aspen, where they've invested millions in turning water into flakes, the machines only cover 10% of the ski area.
We can turn these on individually. Water and electricity are required.
And Rich Berkeley, vice president of mountain operations for Aspen Skiing Company, says making snow is energy intensive.
We will blow about 200 million gallons of snow, of water, and convert it into snow. And that sounds like a lot, but that's in the natural environment and in other resorts, it's a very small amount of snow that we make. It's energy intensive, there's no doubt about it. So when we're at full capacity across the four mountains, we're using about 10 meg of power, which is the kind of a power equivalency of a small town.
That kind of power is too costly for many resorts to sustain. It also adds to carbon emissions. So to help lower its carbon footprint, Aspen is trying to go green. Everything from more efficient lighting to powering its electricity with methane vented from a coal mine.
We are just finishing now bringing our third 1 megawatt generator online. So we have 3 1-megawatt generators that are being powered by this methane that was just being vented in the atmosphere. So destroy carbon, make money.
While a big snowstorm like the one that hit this February may be a short-term boon to the resorts in the Northeast, Burakowski says it does not reverse long-term trends.
Over the long term, like since the 1930s, we have seen decreasing trends in snowfall, including in the Northeast U.S. In terms of what we really care about, is whether that snowfall stays on the ground. But the number of days with snow cover has been dropping off pretty precipitously.
And while this season is looking better than the last one for Colorado, the possibility of shorter winters has skiers like Chris Davenport concerned.
By traveling around and seeing these things firsthand, it really is shocking. I come back to my own home and I go, oh my gosh, what are we going to do about it? I have three small children. I want my kids to grow up seeing the same glaciers and enjoying the same long winters that I've been able to enjoy, and I fear that they're not going to be able to do that.
A chilling thought for all skiers.
Since our visit to New Hampshire's Campton Mountain, the ski area has been able to open, but not under the best conditions. We have much more online for Science Wednesday, including a look at the challenges of making snow for resorts and pictures from our viewers who share their own stories, how snow shortages have affected their winter sports plans.